Cisco Certified Network Associate Day 41. Welcome back everyone. I'm Imran Rafai, your trainer for this entire series. Today we're going to look at two important topics. That'll be DHCP snooping and default native VLAN. Without wasting much time, let's get straight into today's class. And like always, before we move ahead, please click on that subscribe button and click on that bell icon to be notified when we add a new video. Also, please don't forget to hit on that like button, which would make us very, very happy. Do you want to improve your memory? Then click on that button on the top right hand corner now to visit our other channel, where our first video is how to improve your memory. I recommend you to subscribe to that channel because that is a channel where we will be having a lot of self-improvement videos. So go subscribe to that channel right away and like that video. Our social media contacts: on the left you would find Networking Consultant, Networking Inc. and Networking Inc. for Facebook, YouTube and Twitter. On the right, my personal social media contacts. If you want my email, that's imran.rafai@nwking.org. So what are we going to look at today? Today, we would be continuing from 1.7 that we did last time. We looked at 1.7a802.1x, which is one of the threat on access layer, right? Like, you know, 1.7 talks about three access layer threats and how to mitigate that. So we discussed 802.1x last video. We would be dealing with DHCP snooping and non-default native VLAN in this video. So before we talk about DHCP snooping, we need to revisit some of the topics that we did in our old video. So we discussed about DHCP. So I would request all of you to go back. I think it is day 6. And then also day 24, I believe, where we had discussed about DHCP. So day 6 is important, where we discussed about DHCP assignment of IP addresses, the messages that they exchange, like the DORA process. So watch that video if you don't remember that. Watch day 6 and come back here. So in a typical scenario, an end user comes to the network. So when it gets connected to the network, it sends a discover message. So it's a broadcast message that sends onto the network a discover message. It's a broadcast. Everybody in the network listens to that, right? So typically what it would do is, once it reaches, if there is a DHCP server in the network, it would respond. But if there's no DHCP server, if there's a DHCP relay, in this case this router acts as a relay, so this router will forward that to the DHCP server. DHCP server would then send an offer with an IP address. Then this device would communicate with that server, and then that server would finally acknowledge that they have accepted that IP address, right? So this is the normal process, how it would be. So if this real DHCP server signs an IP address, it would have an IP address in that range, let's say 192.168.10.10, right? And it would have the gateway to .1, right? This would be the ideal gateway because this is the exit point for this network, and then they can access the internet or other networks through this device, right? That's the normal way what should be happening. But let's assume in the network there is a rogue attacker who has actually installed a DHCP server on their computer. So when an end user comes in, like last time, and sends a broadcast message, of course the relay agent would forward that to the DHCP server. But this DHCP server, the rogue DHCP server, which is already in the network, would listen to that broadcast and send an offer, right? So a DHCP discover, the DHCP offer would come from here. And because he's already received an offer, the end user would accept it, right? It would say, okay, I accept it. So it'll request for that IP address, and then they would send. So the DORA process, D-O-R-A. D, discover message. O is offer message. R is request message. A is acknowledgement, right? So this would happen here, and this end user device would get an IP address. So what an attacker would do is, he will give him genuine IP address. So it will be like 192.168.10.2, which is part of this network. But if you see, the gateway would be .95, which is nothing but this device's IP address. So what it would do, let me just raise the board. What it would do is all traffic henceforth from the end user going to the internet would first come here, because according to the IP address given, he is the gateway, so he would send all traffic to the gateway. And the attacker's PC, what it would do in turn is take the traffic and send it to the real gateway. And for the end user, there is no difference because he can access the internet. So they're trying to reach the internet. They can reach the internet, but the only problem is the traffic is going through an intermediate device. So return traffic would also come like that. It would go to this device and then it would go here, right? This is called man-in-the-middle attack, right? Because every traffic that is going through the network for this computer is going through the attacker's computer, and he can actually read everything, right? So this is man-in-the-middle attack. So this is one of the attacks that can happen on a DHCP network, right? The second type of attack that happens is called denial of service attack. So in this case, what happens is the DHCP server, now he's not a server, so he's an attacker. What he would do is he would send a discover packet, right? So the real DHCP server, because he gets a discover message, he would send an offer, right? So he would accept it. So he'd request for that IP address, and then he would send an ACK, right? So this he does once. After maybe about 2 minutes, he would again request it, two, three. So he will continuously keep asking for a new IP address. Now, in typical world in DHCP, when it leases an IP address, when an administrator configure, you configure a pool, right? And a pool, typically you would have 100 IP address, 200 IP address, depending on how the administrator has configured, you would have 100, 200 IP addresses. So the attacker, what they would do by doing a denial of service attack is it'll keep requesting for an IP address. So every time they lease an IP address, that IP address is valid for 1 day. Typically it's 1 day, but you could change that lease time. So 1 day, that's 24 hours. So they would lease IP address 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, and it would exhaust that pool. So once the pool is exhausted, he wouldn't have another IP address to give to a new client. So if there's another genuine user comes in, they will not have, this server will not have a free IP address. It would assume that all the IP addresses given are leased, and that lease expiry is 24 hours later, right? So this is a way of doing denial of service attack, where they would exhaust or they would starve the DHCP server of any usable IP address. So these are the problems with DHCP. Now, how do we get out of this? How do we mitigate this attack or these types of attacks? We use a concept called DHCP snooping. So what is DHCP snooping? DHCP snooping, for all practical purpose, is like an ACL, right? But only thing is DHCP snooping is a layer 2 function, right? So it works only on a switch. To understand DHCP snooping, we need to understand two types of ports. One is called a trusted port, and another is called as an untrusted port. So what's the difference between trusted port and untrusted port? On a trusted port, every type of DHCP message would be let through, right? Whatever message, DHCP message, would be let through because it's trusted port. On an untrusted port, we will not, right? DHCP snooping logic will not let any messages that is not supposed to come from end users, right? So basically, if you remember the DORA process, in DORA process, D is from the client, O is from the server, right? So D goes from client to server, O, which is offer, comes from server to client, then R goes from client to server, A comes from server to client, right? So from untrusted ports, these messages D and R would be accepted. But if there is a O, offer or acknowledge, coming from untrusted port, that will get blocked. They will not send through, right? So basically, trusted and untrusted, that's what it does. When you enable DHCP snooping, by default, all the ports of the switch is untrusted, right? It goes into untrusted. So the minute, you can enable DHCP snooping either globally on all the ports, or you can go enable DHCP snooping via VLAN, right? So if there are 5 ports in that VLAN like 10, and if you enable DHCP snooping for VLAN 10, those 10 ports would be untrusted. So the DHCP snooping only is going to work on those 5 or 10 ports, whatever ports are there part of that VLAN, right? Now, like I said, the minute you enable DHCP snooping, all the ports are untrusted. Now, as an administrator, what you would do is you would go and configure all the ports that's connected to devices like a server, right? A server, not DHCP, any type of server. You would make that port as trusted, or maybe if it's connected to another switch, that is also a trusted port, or if it's connected to a router, that is also a trusted port, right? Any port that's connected to an end user, right? Any end user device, that has to be untrusted. If it's connected to a wireless access point, that also has to be an untrusted port, because wireless access point in turn is connected to end user devices, right? So anything coming from an end user device has to be untrusted. So if it's an end user device, obviously, even if, let's say, for instance, now this guy is an attacker, right? Now, if he is trying to send any server messages like an offer message or an acknowledgement message, this will get blocked, right? That type of traffic will not go through a DHCP snooping's untrusted port, right? This is how DHCP snooping prevents DHCP attacks that we looked at earlier, right? Also DHCP snooping would keep a binding table. A binding table is whenever a DHCP server assigns an IP address, it is going to look at the MAC address and IP address, right? So we spoke about denial of service attack, right? So we know that certain MAC address asks for an IP address and that was assigned. Now if the same MAC address device asks for an IP address again, it would know that this is an abnormality, because this MAC address just recently asked for an IP address and an IP address was assigned. Why is it asking for another IP address, right? That is a typical problem where attacker is trying to get more than one. It's trying to do a denial of service attack. So that will immediately be prevented. So that traffic, that request would be prevented. Also, it knows which port number has which IP address because it's keeping this binding table. So this binding table also helps them make a decision of what MAC address is using what IP address, right? So this is how DHCP snooping prevents DHCP attacks that we discussed. The next thing we're going to talk about is non-default native VLAN. Now, VLAN is a topic that we discussed many, many times. I think we dedicated 4 videos for VLAN. So if you still have confusion about VLANs, I would request you to go back and watch those videos. I think it's day 11, day 12, day 13, and day 34 or 24. I don't know, but go back and watch those videos. Now, what we're going to talk about today is non-default native VLAN. Now, we know what a native VLAN is, right? And default native VLAN. By default, native VLAN in a Cisco switch is VLAN 1, right? VLAN 1 is the native VLAN. That's default native VLAN. Now, there is a type of attack called as a VLAN hopping attack. Now, if you know how switches tag packets, let's say for instance, this is VLAN 1, right? And now the default native VLAN is 1, right? So this is VLAN 1 and this is VLAN 10, right? Now, typically when traffic comes from here, right, this switch knows that this port is part of VLAN 1, right? So when this traffic goes out onto a trunk, the switch looks at that traffic and says, okay, you're a VLAN 1 traffic. That's my native VLAN. So I'm not going to tag you. So it'll go untagged. That traffic will go untagged to switch 2, right? This is switch 2 and this is switch 1, right? I'm going to put this. Now, when this switch 2 receives that packet, it says, okay, you're coming untagged. That means you are VLAN 1, which is my native VLAN. And hence, you can't go into VLAN 10 traffic, right? So I can't send that traffic to this computer, right? That's how it should be. That's the way it has to be there, right? So VLAN 1 traffic should not be able to go to VLAN 10, right? Now, let's assume the same thing. This is an attacker now. Now, what an attacker does is he creates a packet with a VLAN tag of VLAN 10. Now, this is VLAN 10, like we discussed earlier, VLAN 10, and this is VLAN 1, right? Now, this attacker creates a frame with a VLAN 10 tag on it, right? So, this is a frame, and then there is a VLAN 10 tag on it, right? And he sends that on to the switch. Now, this switch gets that traffic. If you know how VLAN works, when it comes into the switch doesn't do anything to the frame. Whatever frame it receives, it doesn't touch anything. It touches only at the trunk. When it's non-default native VLAN traffic, it tags it. So if at all it is the default native VLAN tag, it doesn't tag anything. It just sends that same traffic out onto switch 2. Now when switch 2 receives that, this frame has a tag in it, right? Switch 1 did not do this tag. This tag was done by the attacker. So switch 2 does not know that. Switch 2 sees that there is a tag and the tag is VLAN 10. So it takes a traffic and it sends here to this computer, right? That traffic goes through because what just happened is we did a VLAN hopping attack. This is something that should not happen. How do we mitigate this? First thing is create a random VLAN, right? Just a random VLAN, 999, 666, 777, whatever you want. Create a random VLAN. And that VLAN should not be used at all. It's just a dummy VLAN we keep so that we don't become a victim to VLAN hopping attacks. So just create a random VLAN. Don't assign any ports to that VLAN. And go to each of these trunks, right? And change the native VLAN to that. Let's say, for instance, 666. Change the native VLAN to 666 on both sides. If you don't change on both sides, you will have a CDP VLAN, native VLAN mismatch error, right? So go to both sides of the trunk and all the trunks and make the native VLAN as 666 and make sure that you don't assign any ports to this VLAN. So it'll be a dead VLAN. So even if somebody wants to do a VLAN hopping attack, it will not work because the native VLAN is a VLAN that is not part of any of the ports in your switch, right? So this is how you mitigate a VLAN hopping attack, and that is why a non-default native VLAN should be assigned to your device. Thank you so much for watching. We'll be back very, very soon. Now, if you look at the exam topics, you see that from the next video, we would be getting into the most sought after part of our ICND 2 series, which is OSPF and EIGRP routing. So, and from next video, we would be starting routing. Stay tuned, guys. We will be back very, very soon. Take care. Bye-bye.